Penguin Random House Audio presents After the Funeral and Other Stories by Tessa Hadley. Read for you by Abigail Thaw.
After the Funeral. After the funeral, the two little girls, aged 9 and 7, accompanied their grief-stricken mother home. Naturally, they were grief-stricken also. But then again, they hadn't known their father very well and hadn't enormously liked him. He was an airline pilot, and they'd preferred it when he was away working. Being alert little girls, they'd picked up intimations that he preferred it too. This was in the 1970s when air travel was still supposed to be glamorous. Philip Lyons had flown 747s across the Atlantic for BOAC until he died of a heart attack. Luckily, not while he was in the air, but on the ground, prosaically eating breakfast in a New York hotel room. The airline had flown him home free of charge. All the girls' concentration was on their mother, Marlene, who couldn't cope. Throughout the funeral service, she didn't even cry. She was numb, huddled in her black Persian lamb coat, petite and soft and pretty in dark glasses, with muzzy, licorice brown hair and red sugar date lipstick. Her daughters suspected that she had a very unclear idea of what was going on. It was January, and a patchy sprinkling of snow lay over the stone-cold ground and the graves in a bleak, impersonal cemetery in the Thames Valley. Marlene had apparently never been to a funeral before. The girls hadn't either, but they picked things up quickly. They had known already from television, for instance, that their mother ought to wear dark glasses to the graveside, and they'd hunted for sunglasses in the chest of drawers in her bedroom, which was suddenly their terrain now, liberated from the possibility of their father's arriving home ever again. Lulu had bounced on the peach candlewick bedspread while Charlotte went through the drawers. During the various fascinating stages of the funeral ceremony, the girls were aware of their mother peering surreptitiously around, unable to break with her old habit of expecting Philip to arrive, to get her out of this. "Your father will be here soon," she used to warn them vaguely and helplessly when they were running riot, screaming and hurtling around the bungalow in some game or other. The reception after the funeral was to be at their Nana's place, Philip's mother. Charlotte could read the desperate pleading in Marlene's eyes, fixed on her now from behind the dark lenses. "Oh, no, I can't," Marlene said to her older daughter quickly, furtively. "I can't meet all those people." So Charlotte took charge, arranging with a funeral director who was willing to give them a lift home in his hearse, and then breaking the news to Nana, who was affronted, but couldn't be surprised by any new revelation of Marlene's inadequacy. Nana was a tall, straight-backed widow, whose white hair was cut sensibly short. She collected old Delft and read all the new novels and taught piano, only not to Lulu, who had wriggled and slid off the piano stool, wanting to press the pedals with her hands. Charlotte practiced religiously but wasn't musical, her Nana said. Of course, Nana was grieving too, for her youngest son. Her other sons were a doctor and a dentist, and although she used to talk deprecatingly about Philip's flying, as if it was something rash like running away to join a circus or a pop group, the girls understood now that this meant he'd been her favourite. Nana had lost her baby boy and was inconsolable, like a tragic actress in a film. Charlotte and Lulu looked volumes at each other. At home, they fussed around Marlene, who submitted limply to their ministrations. They kissed her and took off admiringly, piece by piece, in reverse order, all the items they'd dressed her in for the day's drama. Sunglasses, black chiffon headscarf, royal blue gloves because she didn't possess black, high-heeled black patent leather slingbacks, the beloved Persian lamb they enveloped again tenderly in its clinging polythene. Then they sat her down on the sofa in front of the television and turned on the children's programmes. Lulu, pressing up against her, stroked her left hand with its wedding ring, which shone with a sober new significance. Charlotte, feeling grown up, boiled the kettle and made tea in the pot for them all, stirring 2 teaspoons of sugar into each mug, and a not extravagant dollop of whiskey from the bottle, plus extra milk in Lulu's. She got out the biscuit barrel from where it was supposed to be hidden in a high cupboard by standing on a stool, as usual. Marlene couldn't reach the high cupboard either without using the stool. They ate a lot of biscuits, and Charlotte made toast under the grill with its real flames. Later, their Uncle Richard, the dentist, turned up to make sure they were all right, bringing leftover food that Nana had sent from the reception, sandwiches and coleslaw and Madeira cake, also 2 servings of jelly with mandarin oranges set in it for the little girls. The sisters felt a hostility to this uncle, which wasn't rational, but based on their sessions in his terrible chair, equipped so exquisitely for torturing them. Now it was Richard's turn to be made uncomfortable. Clearly he didn't know where to look, in the face of his nieces and sister-in-law's predicament, and what he assumed were the excesses of their emotion. His brother's death was an embarrassment, brash and scene-stealing, he thought, like everything Philip had ever done. Not only that, but the black cocktail dress Marlene was wearing, it was the only black thing she'd got, was very low-cut. For the duration of the funeral, the girls had made sure she kept her cardigan buttoned over it. Richard was rather like Philip in appearance, tall and burly and sandy. As soon as Marlene saw him, she lunged into his arms, breaking into hysterical weeping. Uneasily, he extricated himself. "Now come on, Marlene. You have to buck up, you know."
"But I've lost everything," she sobbed.
"Well, not everything. You've got your girls. You have to be brave for them."
"I can't be brave without Philip. I can't be."
"You have to look to the future."
"I don't want the future. I want Philip back. I should have thrown myself into his grave today. I wish I was dead too."
Impressed, the sisters exchanged glances, and Richard saw it. "Isn't it time these girls were in bed?" he said severely. Then Lulu too burst loudly into tears, hiding her face against her mother's half-bare breasts, arms squeezed around Marlene's small waist so that she couldn't unfasten them. Richard was out of his depth. Only Charlotte could calm them all down. When he'd gone, she looked in the Radio Times and found that at 9:25 on BBC One, there was an episode of one of their favourites, Ironside. They watched it while eating the ham sandwiches and crisps, snuggled together, as always for the telly, under a wool blanket on the sofa. Charlotte only just remembered not to exclaim, "Isn't this cosy?" Marlene used to put the blanket back in the spare room whenever their father was due home, but now there was no one, ever again, to stop them enjoying themselves. By the time Ironside was over, Marlene was fast asleep, exhausted by sorrow, snoring lightly with her mouth open and her eyebrows, plucked to a thin line, raised quizzically. The girls crept into the kitchen. Lulu stood on tiptoe to see over the top of the kitchen counter, surveying what their uncle had brought them from the party. "Nana sent us jelly," Charlotte said, "in her special best glass dishes for a treat." Lulu was small like her mother, and her wide face was pink and creamy as an angel's in a painting. Dark eyes set far apart under thick lashes. The mass of her dark brown corkscrew curls shivering with impatient energy. She took one of the jelly dishes carefully in her 2 hands, lifted it up over her head, and before Charlotte had time to grasp what she intended, let it fall deliberately on the tiled floor, where it smashed in a satisfactory splat of red jelly and orange segments. Shards of glass went skidding across the floor and under the cupboards. They heard their mother stirring in the sitting room, but knew she hadn't woken, because she would have called out to them. After a moment's frozen outrage, Charlotte stepped over the mess to smack her sister hard across the face. Charlotte was tall for her age, and very thin, with her pale hair cut short like a boy's. Her grey eyes were huge, and their heavy lids, dropping over her expression like shutters, conveyed her burden of responsibility. As Lulu prepared to break out in wailing, Charlotte shook her urgently by the shoulders. "We have to clean this up," she said. "We'll tell them it was an accident. They're bound to forgive us, today of all days. But we can't ever be..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.